as a species are living longer.
Right now, the average American lives for about 80 years. And the question is, how long could we live? We actually don't know the answer to that.
This question is at the center of the burgeoning field of longevity science, and biotech startups believe we are closer than ever to unprecedented lifespan. A recent explosion of longevity startups has created a new speculative industry almost overnight. Oxford Economics estimated longevity to be worth $7.6 trillion.
In order to reach its potential, right, really needs to have a way of getting to the market as fast as we can possibly do it.
But some fear whatever breakthrough may happen will never really serve the average person. Rather, it will favor the few who are sinking their fortunes into these startups.
It's a pretty concentrated group of investors. From our estimates, it's like nearly 50% has come from individuals.
That's a nicer way of saying billionaires.
I have to be honest, a large part is egoistic because the billionaires, they are getting older and they have a lot of money and they still have a lot of ambitions. They want to live longer when they age better.
When people think about longevity, the thing that comes to mind is usually, you know, some eccentric billionaire trying to live forever. But what longevity really is just the science of helping us live longer, and also the science of helping us live more healthfully.
Anything that comes out of this space won't be just for the rich.
Humans have been trying to cheat death since we climbed down from the trees. The Fountain of Youth was a mythical place where you could drink waters from its springs to rejuvenate your aging body. It first appeared in writing around the 5th century BC, and the search hasn't stopped since. Folklore has it that Spanish explorer Ponce de Leon searched in vain for magical waters with restorative powers in modern-day Florida and the Bahamas. But historians agree that most of his time was actually spent searching for something a bit more earthly. Not only was he searching for gold, but expeditions like his were expensive and in constant need of fundraising from the throne across the Atlantic. Today, the modern quest for prolonged youth remains very expensive.
Last year, more than $2 billion in venture funding went into the longevity space. So this is a space that people are excited about and they are putting their money into it.
But this expedition is funded mostly by a different sort of royalty.
We have heard recently, you know, that famous people such as Jeff Bezos invested not only millions, but actually billions into new startup companies. And I think, you know, it is totally justified, this investment.
While this narrative of the super rich making an elixir of life for themselves at the expense of the rest of the world makes for good Bond villain material, it doesn't hold up to close scrutiny.
I love this. The narrative about lots of billionaires coming into this longevity space, it's played up more than it needs to be. Because in general, like VC funds, are backed by billionaires or families of billionaires. This is sort of the artery of the worldwide innovation economy is people who have the capital on hand to be able to do these big, sometimes risky investments.
I don't think that impression is entirely wrong, but it's also not fully correct, and it really fails to recognize the ways in which the edges of human knowledge and capacity are always explored on the outskirts by a handful of individuals who are uniquely motivated and uniquely resourced. It never happens with technology that somehow that then stays secretive and closed up in a box and only effective for them.
As it turns out, the science of pharmacology and even the basic laws of supply and demand don't really allow for an elite superdrug.
That first pill that you create, or that first injection, or whatever it is, that might cost, you know, $500 million to make that first pill. The second one probably costs a fraction of a penny. And so if you were to do the math of like the supply and demand aspects of this, it doesn't make sense to make a really expensive medicine that only a few billionaires take when you can make something really cheap, but make it for everybody.
And there's another reason why private billionaires and VCs are flooding this space. As it turns out, longevity health doesn't exactly fit into the current healthcare model, making it risky and more complicated to traditional pharmaceutical investors.
The major regulatory bodies that look at states of disease, so the CDC, the FDA, they don't consider death an illness. Of all of the clinical endpoints that we generally look at therapeutics alleviating the suffering of humans, interestingly, death isn't one of them. Many people, very accurately, particularly as we live longer and healthier lives, are pausing and saying, well, wait, why do I wait to get involved with the healthcare system until I'm sick? And why is there no baseline of what being healthy is? There have been a lot of people with resources, i.e. billionaires, who are saying, I know the best practices for living long and healthy lives, but what are the treatments to alleviate some of these symptoms of aging? And all the classic investors in the space said, I don't really know how to fathom that. I don't know what to do with these kind of soft clinical endpoints. And I absolutely don't know how to invest on a metric of you make an investment today, you engage with a therapeutic practice, and then hopefully we find out in 50 years that you lived 10 healthier years than you might have otherwise, right? That feedback loop is way too long. And that's really what's enabled investors like ourselves to start participating in this market.
What's more, longevity science itself challenges much of the healthcare status quo as we know it. Everyone in the space agrees that for real longevity to be achieved, there needs to be a massive paradigm shift.
We are locked into a system where we wait for people to get sick and then try to treat them. And that system worked really well 100 years ago when infectious diseases were the cause of death for everybody. If you come in with a heart attack or with stage 3 cancer or with early stage Alzheimer's disease, so much has already broken down in our bodies by the time that that doctor has seen that patient that it is so complex to imagine how we would fix all of the pieces that have come apart. All of these future technologies, these future medicines, they're built around this idea of prevention. The notion that we could switch from a healthcare system that is primarily reactive, wait for someone to get sick, to one that is more proactive, right? Give someone a drug so that they could then stay healthy. So a more technically accurate term for a longevity drug would be a multi-disease preventative, something that can keep you from getting cancer or Alzheimer's disease or having a heart attack. The amazing potential of this science is that we could have a single drug that makes all of those things happen further in the future than they would otherwise have.
As of today, a single longevity drug remains as real as the fountain of youth. And experts agree that regardless of the technology, longevity is a multi-pronged effort, using everything from biomarkers and cellular rejuvenation to gene editing, diet, and exercise. There will likely never be a one-size-fits-all solution. And to accomplish this, longevity startups are taking an interdisciplinary approach to the science.
Scientists have really started breaking down all of the little things that happen to us as we age, and there are a lot of them. But I like to break them down into three categories. Our top category is stuff that happens at the whole tissue level, we call it, like changes in how our tissues are put together. We have stem cells that get exhausted as we age, and now they can't make new copies of themselves. And then if you zoom in into the cell, there are changes that happen at the molecular level, specific molecules that can't be broken down by our normal recycling mechanisms that build up little by little as we get older.
The business model of these startups largely mirror this diverse approach, casting a wide net across both academic science and pharmacology.
It's kind of a new model where you don't focus on one single technology or one single therapeutic area, because longevity is a very complex approach where many biological mechanisms are interacted and intertwined. So we'd like to have the scientists interacting with each other, even though they have a specific scientific field. We have like an incubator space. We bring in a cutting-edge science. We collaborate with academic leaders in the field, and we bring in scientific entrepreneurs to bring this breakthrough science into our labs here in Zurich. So we have labs and offices, and then we have very experienced traditional pharma people who know how to discover and develop drugs in this completely novel field.
We find a great scientist who has made a discovery, bring it into Cambrian, and then use the fact that we have a team of chemists and drug developers and researchers and, you know, people who understand the biotech market and all of this to foster that internally.
This aggregation model helps biotechs hedge their bets against an admittedly high-risk venture.
Drug development is risky, right? So when you start a drug in clinical trials or human trials, you only have about a 1 in 7 chance of that drug making it all the way through its 3 phases of clinical trials to approval. But if you pull together 20 of these different ideas into one entity and resource them all, then all of a sudden that risk goes up to about a 95% chance that you'll get at least one hit. And so the math of drug development makes a lot more sense as a collective than as individuals.
Even with so many bets on the table, there's no guarantee that a breakthrough will happen under their roof. Recently, a study funded through traditional grants out of the Salk Institute successfully extended the lifespan of mice. And while mouse studies are not considered breakthrough discoveries, it has gotten the attention of the scientific community.
We developed an approach called partial reprogramming, basically where we express a set of genes which can actually reprogram the cells without losing their identity. We were able to erase the signs of aging. We were able to extend its life by 30% almost. So basically this kind of demonstrate that partial reprogramming is a way to reverse some of the aging marks in cells and tissues, and which can eventually have a beneficial effect on the whole organism. The partial reprogramming approach was even tested in human cells. So we were able to take cells from an aged individual and apply this partial reprogramming and erase the signs of aging in the cells. So the conceptually, it works even in human cells.
The key word here is conceptually.
The science is in such early stages and it grows every day. What we have is all of these really interesting data points, right? From human studies, from mouse studies, but we're many, many years, if not decades, away from concrete answers that tell us how these things contribute to how we age.
And this speaks to another misconception about longevity. This community as a whole isn't so much focused on increasing our lifespan as much as they are on improving our quality of life as we age.
It's not our aim, and I don't think anyone can prevent death, right? Ultimately, we will still all die. But our aim is that until we die, that we have the best life that we can have.
In the longevity world, almost nobody's talking about lifespan. They're all talking about health span, the amount of time that we spend in good health. And if we prioritize extending health span, increasing lifespan may be a side effect of that.